Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java Developer Advocate at Oracle, and today I got two topics for you. First, random number generation, why the status quo had to change, and how Java 17 makes the API more usable, extensible, and robust. And second, JDK Flight Recorder, how to get started, what to look out for on Java 16, and where to get more information. Ready? Then let's dive right in. Java's API around random numbers is a bit muddied. First and foremost, there's the class random, which has a solid API. Then there are its subclasses, secure random, which is slower but a cryptographically strong random number generator, and thread local random, which is faster than random but not thread safe because you're not supposed to share it across threads. Then, off to the side, we have splittable random, which is also not thread safe but has a method split that returns a new splittable random that you can pass to a task in a newly spawned thread. This works great for fork join style computations. The streams of random numbers splittable random returns employ this functionality when used as a parallel stream. But have you ever tried replacing random with splittable random? They're unrelated, so it can be a bit cumbersome. Then there are some methods, like the ones where you pass an upper bound for a next number, that you can find on some classes but not others. And apparently they aren't doing great under the hood either, with a few identical pieces of code in several classes. And because there is no overarching interface, third parties can't easily provide drop-in replacements. But all of that is about to change. Because thanks to the work done as part of Java Enhancement Proposal 356, Java 17 ships with a new and better Random Generator API. At its core is the new interface Random Generator, with an API that's basically that of random plus a few methods it was missing, like the ones with the upper bound I mentioned earlier. Its implementations are not required to be thread-safe or cryptographically secure. The four pre-existing classes we just discussed were all refactored to share more of their code and make future RNGs easier to implement. They were also expanded to provide the full API of Random Generator, which they now implement. All of this while being 100% backwards compatible, of course. Then, there are five additional interfaces that extend Random Generator. The differentiating factor is how you can use one such generator to create another one that is statistically independent and individually uniform, or some approximation thereof, so you can pass them off to a new thread. Streamable generator can return a stream of random generators. This is helpful because if a generator can create a set of new generators all at once, it can make a special effort to ensure that they're statistically independent. How can a generator create another generator? That depends on the underlying algorithm. Some can return a new generator by jumping forward a number of draws, depending on how many they implement jumpable generator, leapable generator, or arbitrarily jumpable generator. Then we have splittable generator, which prescribes the behavior I described earlier for splittable random, meaning a generator that can split itself into two. As mentioned before, all four existing classes extend the top-level interface random generator. Furthermore, splittable random also implements splittable generator. That means you can either keep using the existing classes or migrate towards the new interfaces to make it easier to exchange implementations, similarly to list versus ArrayList and linked list. No new public classes were added though, so how do you get an instance of, say, leapable generator? First of all, a few new algorithms have been implemented and more will likely come in the future. I know next to nothing about this complicated field though, so I'm not going to speak to any specific algorithm. Instead, I'll assume you know what you're looking for and I will tell you how to get it. Deal? Generally speaking, all the new interfaces have a static off method that takes an algorithm's name as a string argument. If an algorithm of that name is implemented and it adheres to the interface off is called on, it will return an instance of it. Otherwise, it throws an illegal argument exception. So to create a leapable generator, you can call leapable generator of Soshiro256++. Obviously. The Java doc contains a list of algorithms that all JDK implementations must contain, but any specific JDK may add more. Due to advances in random number generator algorithm development and analysis, this list isn't set in stone though. Algorithms can be deprecated at any time and can be removed in major JDK versions. So picking algorithms by name may not be the best way to write robust code. If you don't have any specific requirements, you can use random generator get default to get an arbitrary algorithm. If you need more control, you can use the new class random generator factory. It also has a static of name method which returns a factory for a specific algorithm, but that doesn't help with writing more robust code. For that, you can call the static method all, which will return a stream of factories, one per algorithm. The cool thing about that is that you can query factories for properties of the algorithm. Is it jumpable, leapable, or splittable? But also how many state bits it has, whether it uses a hardware device, or what its equidistribution is. You can then filter by your specific requirements, find any factory that fulfills them, and use it to create a random generator. Beyond the JDK, third parties can also implement random number generators. The interface random generator is registered as a service, so any jar can provide their own implementations of it. By using the annotation @randomGenerator properties, the information that I mentioned before, state bits, equidistribution, etc., can be attached to it. The JDK classes will then pick up these implementations, and on the use side, they integrate perfectly with the mechanisms I described, be it the static factory off methods or the more robust random generator factory approach. So, in summary, a new hierarchy of interfaces makes it easier to identify key properties of an algorithm and to switch between implementations. The four existing random number classes got refactored, slightly extended, and now implement those interfaces while their behavior stays as is. New algorithms have been and will be implemented as internal classes. Factories can be used to robustly pick algorithms that fulfill specific requirements. And now, I'll hand you over to my colleague Billy, who will give you a quick intro to the JDK Flight Recorder.
Thank you, Nikolai. Hey Java developers, running into a difficult to debug production issue, frustrating performance issues, or just want to get a detailed understanding of how your application is performing in production? All the above? We have all been there at one point or another in our careers. Well, for those occasions, JDK Flight Recorder might be the tool for you. JDK Flight Recorder, previously known as Java Flight Recorder before being open source as part of JDK 11, is a JVM tool for performing diagnostic and profiling of Java applications and the JVM. A key characteristic of JFR is it has very low overhead, often less than 1%, though this can vary depending upon system and how JFR is configured. This means JFR can be used in production even under a heavy load without meaningfully impacting performance, allowing you to use JFR to find those hard to detect performance issues or bugs that only seem to come up in production. If you have a running Java application, you can actually try out JFR right now. No, really. From your command line, run jcommand-l. You will get back a list of Java processes running on your system. You can see an example of what it looks like right here. You can take the PID of the Java process you want to observe, and then run jcommand PID jfr.start, and JFR will start recording events from the entire stack, from the OS layer to the JVM to the Java application itself, giving you a good picture of what's happening. The events are initially recorded to an in-memory buffer, which is part of how JFR is able to keep its performance impact minimal. To pull information from the buffer, we again use jcommand pid jfr.dump, and this will dump the data currently in the JFR buffer to the directory the Java process is running from. So, what do we do with a JFR recording once we have it? For lighter analysis of a JFR file, there's a JFR command. If you already have a concrete idea of what you're looking for, the JFR command can be a great way to quickly analyze a JFR file. However, for most analysis, you'll need a tool like JDK Mission Control, JMC. Opening a recording in JMC, you're given an overall report about performance. And then on the left side of the screen, our several tabs are digging down into what is happening in the application and the JVM. So you have threads, IO, garbage collection, class loading, method profiling, and more can be analyzed. If you look under memory, you might notice it looking a bit empty. If you are using JDK 16, that is because of a change introduced in the latest version of Java. With JDK 16, a new JFR event was added, JDK Object Allocation Sample, which allows low overhead of memory allocation profiling. JMC 8.1, when released, will support rendering this event, but until then, if we want to see memory allocation in JMC, we will need to update our JFC files. This is good, as this will give us an opportunity to look at how to configure JFR. The JFC files are located under Java Home, lib JFR directory. In this directory, there are two provided JFC files, default and profile. Previously, the events JDK Object Allocation Enu TLAB and JDK object allocation outside TLAB have been used to track memory allocation, but have been disabled by default, both in the default and profile JFC files, because they have somewhat high overhead. By setting enable to true for both of these, we can track memory allocations. Additional JFC files can also be defined, and there's a lot of configuration options available, but that's beyond the scope of this segment. For these changes to take effect, we will need to restart our Java application. After doing so, and going through the earlier JD command steps, we can see that more detailed memory allocation info is provided. So far when starting JFR with J command, we simply have been doing JFR.start. However, we are able to pass in several values that can modify JFR's behavior. There are a few key ones, file name for providing a file path and name that's more descriptive than the generated one. Settings, as expected, default is the default settings used, but we could pass in the name of a different JFC file, profile, or a new file we created. Max size limits the size of the buffer JFR will write. The default is 250 megabytes, which is likely larger than needed in most cases. For GraalVM VM users, JFR support was recently announced and is available in GraalVM VM 21.2. A link to a blog post on Red Hat Developer is available in the description that covers this announcement. We only scratched the surface of JFR today. There's a whole lot more to cover. For that, we provided some links to some great talks and documentation in the description. And this may be a topic to return to in a feature of this channel. Until then, this is Billy Carando with the Inside Java Newscast. Nikolai, back to you in the studio. Like with string joiner, the prefix and suffix values are optional. If you only need a delimiter, consider string.join.
That's actually a pretty good idea. Sorry. I was just watching one of Billy's 1 minute videos on Twitter. Because we in the Java community don't have enough coffee-based puns yet, he calls them Sip of Java. But that aside, they're really good. He has one on switch expressions, on collection factories, string join APIs, and look, there's one on JFR as well. Go follow at Billy Carando on Twitter to get those nuggets of Java insights, or click on the links in the description. And that's it for today on the Inside Java Newscast. If you have any questions about what we covered in this episode, ask ahead in the comments below. And if you enjoy this kind of content, help us spread the word with a like or by sharing this video, including the creepy outro, with your friends and colleagues. I'll see you again in 2 weeks. So long. Oh no, I won't. I'll be on vacation in 2 weeks, so my colleague Jose Pomar will be there for you. I'll see you in 4.